Harper Business and Harper Audio present Skip the Line, the 10,000 Experiments Rule and Other Surprising Advice for Reaching Your Goals by James Altucher. This is the author. Introduction. You can't do that. She's the head of marketing at HBO. I'm walking towards the CEO's office. It's 1995. The CEO is my boss's 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 boss. My official title at HBO is Junior Analyst Software Developer. If I worked hard, I'd get a promotion to Senior Analyst Software Developer. Cindy says, you can't just walk into the CEO's office and tell him an idea. Do you know how many people have ideas for a show who have been in this business for decades? And you can't just go over your boss's head. You can't skip the line. But I want to change my life. I'm unhappy. My career feels stagnant. I'm not interested in being a junior analyst, whatever. Being comfortable in my nice little cubicle, 6 feet by 6 feet. Even in jail, prisoners often have an 8x8 cell. They have their own bathroom. I don't like going to the bathroom and thinking my boss might be in the stall right next to me. I've ruined my stomach forever by holding it in until work is over. Can I skip the line? I'm going to try, I say. What can I lose? You can lose your job, she says. Nobody does this. But I want to. I want to skip the line. I'm not taking an easy shortcut. My idea is good. Who made the rules that you can't skip the line? I go to the CEO's office. 25 years later, a pandemic shuts down the planet. 40 million people in the United States file for unemployment. The world feels over. People start to riot. There are protests everywhere. As the economy reopens, as the dust starts to clear, we can see the results. Many businesses are just not coming back. Many industries are upside down. Many people are lost in this new world. The ability to change, to find your passion, to get good at it, to make money from it, to feed your family, to be excited again, to want that excitement about getting up in the morning, this has never been more important. They never taught us the skip the line skills in school. They never told us that the world can suddenly become very terrifying unless we know how to live in the land of not knowing. Maybe I'll change my passion again, and again, and again. It's never too late. Everyone is walking around shaken with some kind of societal PTSD. I want to change, people say. I've always wanted to do X, but I thought I had to do Y. From birth, we're told which holidays to celebrate, which schools to go to, which promotions to aim for, which awards and rewards to strive for. I kept believing this until I was on the floor, flirting with the worst, no optimism left. The time to learn to skip the line is now, but the time to learn to skip the line was always now. We just forgot that. I live 4 blocks from the World Trade Center on 9/11. It was such a beautiful morning, just around 8:30 a.m., September 11th, 2001. The stock markets had been down for several days in a row, and I had made a big bet the night before that the markets would bounce back. At that moment, the stock market looked like it would open up big, and I was excited to make money. I'm having breakfast at the Dean and DeLuca on the bottom floor of One World Trade Center. My then business partner, Dan, and I start walking back towards my apartment. Dan turns to me and says, "Is the president coming in today?" Points up in front of us to a low-flying jet cutting through the sky right towards us. A second later, a microsecond, a second that will never repeat, everyone on the street instinctively ducks. My eyes open. I see the plane scream straight into the building, accompanied by the loudest sound ever. Imagine a god opening up the door of a giant attic. Dan and I run to the nearest fire station. We want to help. One guy throws us 2 suits to wear inside the buildings. Put these on. And then he asks, "Are you guys firefighters?" "No, but we can help." "Forget it. You have to be firefighters." And he and the other guys in the fire station put on their suits, get in the truck, turn on the siren, and leave. Many died less than an hour later as the buildings crashed in on them. We go back towards the smoking buildings. People are throwing themselves off the top. From a distance, they look like black little squiggles twisting in the air. Up closer, you see the more familiar outlines of bodies. Then the buildings start to shake and then tumble, sending up enormous amounts of smoke and blackness. We run back to my apartment. The black cloud covers the entire building. My little daughter had peed on the floor, and when she hears this that I put this in here, I wonder if she's going to be upset at me. But nevertheless, she peed on the floor. Everyone is scared. People had gathered in my apartment are crying. Everyone feels powerless. Nobody knows what to do. Announcements blasted over a bullhorn tell us to leave the area, but we don't. Is it safer outside or inside, we wonder. Our windows are pitch black, all the dust and destruction trying to pound their way into the apartment. We stay up all night, taking turns listening to the radio, and the next day, part two of Everyone's Lives begins. A few months later, I'm dead broke from day trading. I knew nothing about day trading, but I had gambled away millions of dollars. At night, I dream of enormous tidal waves sweeping over Manhattan, and I wake the moment I realize in the dream that I can't run fast enough to escape. I desperately want to sell my house. I've already lowered the price 3 times, but there are no buyers. Every day I call the broker, and he says, move the price down again. But I don't want to, but I have to do it anyway. More waiting. I look in my bank account again, $143. How did this happen? I think I'm smart, but I've been the biggest idiot. I start crying. What am I going to do? I call my wife. I'm supposed to get something from the store, but in my panic, after I saw my bank account, I totally forgot what I'm supposed to get. I go to a payphone. New York City still had them at this time in 2001, and I start dialing, but I don't hear a dial tone. I press the keys, no sounds. I feel something against my ear. I pull the phone away, but it's sticky and grabbing onto my hair. The phone is covered in shit. Human shit, dog shit. I still don't know. And now it's all over my hands and hair. When I was 8 years old and thought my future would take me from success to success, I never would have predicted this moment. I drop the phone quickly. I yell out, but people keep walking by. Dead broke, shit in my hair, and I forgot what I'm supposed to get at the store. That night, I go to my neighbor. I'm desperate. Hey, do you think I can get a job investing at the fund you work for? He looks down, maybe a little embarrassed that he even has to answer me, and he hesitates. I'm feeling red. I'm feeling like I'm going to cry again. I hate asking people for things. He says, you might need a little experience, like maybe a degree in finance, or maybe you need to work at a fund or a bank for a while and start from the bottom. You know, there's a lot of people trying to get into this business. It's hard to skip the line. I really hate when people tell me that. I had to change. Once again, I had to change. I had to change everything. I had to find something I could be obsessed about. I had to get good at it. I had to make money from it. I wanted to feed my family, and I needed to do it right away. I didn't have 10,000 hours. I needed to skip the line. I've woken up in the middle of the night, 3 in the morning, many, many, many times. Opening my eyes into that dark blue, so many voices racing in my head. You feel this and you wonder, whose voices are these? They just won't stop. The lateness of the hour, the dark, the voices. It seems that somehow my heart has taken a wrong turn, that I ended up in someone else's nightmare, running in the maze, captured by words conjured up from a horrible part of me. I can't believe that the young boy, who was once so excited to wake up and play, is now trapped here in this dark blue. When someone tells you you can't do that, don't assume the worst. We're all trying to calm the demons inside of us, the anxieties, the stresses. Where did everyone get these anxieties, these fears? It doesn't matter. Life is more difficult than we ever could have guessed. It only matters that you realize this. Understand that when someone tells you that you can't do something, they are trying to imprint their own goals for you onto you. It is their agenda, their truth, not yours. You don't have to follow their goals. You don't have to give the goals they have for you any of your energy. You don't even have to convince them, because they can't be convinced. They live inside their own piece of this giant simulation. Of all the possibilities in the world that are open to them, the one where you specifically can't is incredibly important to these people. Let their goals just slide past you. They will walk past you muttering to their own ghosts while you move forward towards your own goals. Hope that they will be happier somehow, but don't do more than just hope. Instead, detach from their path, their vision for you, and move towards your own possibilities. Sometimes at 3 a.m, those voices come back, the many can'ts you've been told. When the hour is late and dark and lonely, your resistance to the agendas of others is at its weakest. The brain invites them in, and the heart is not quite awake enough to defend. The ideas in this book are what I hope can wake you up. You aren't lonely in your dreams. You do have power over that darkness. One agenda that many have is A, then B, C, and D, and often they think that's the only path. The possibilities at the moment of greatest despair, are spread out in front of you like when a magician fans out a deck of cards. Pick a card, they say, any card. But it is then that your heart can reach for a card and pick the one that is for you only. Even at that late hour, it's time to skip the line, to explore the universe of possibilities that nobody else even believes exists. It's late and dark and you feel powerless, but you get to pick the card, any card. Jigoro Kano, the founder of judo, was short, 5'2", and very interested in his studies at school. His family moved around a bit after his mother passed away when he was a child. In modern words, he was a nerd. He was frequently bullied by schoolmates much bigger than him, the sort of people who would physically say, "You can't," and make Kano pay if he tried to move forward. Kano learned to defeat his bigger opponents by using their own energy against them. When they were on the attack, they would have a temporary loss of equilibrium. For instance, if they lunged, then at that precise moment, they would be slightly off balance. His approach was to learn to instinctively relax his mind and body at these high-stakes moments and then use his opponent's own energy against them. Maximum efficiency, minimum energy was his approach. He once said, "In short, resisting a more powerful opponent will result in your defeat, whilst adjusting to and evading your opponent's attack will cause him to lose his balance, his power will be reduced, and you will defeat him." This can apply whatever the relative values of power, thus making it possible for weaker opponents to beat significantly stronger ones. The forces of the world will always conspire against you when you try to reach for accomplishments beyond the comfort zone, beyond the straightforward path that most people subscribe to. You will be bullied, maybe not physically, but in many other ways. When someone says, "You can't," or appears to have hostility to you skipping the line to achieve success in your chosen field, the idea of relaxing rather than resisting, of increasing and creating energy based on the actions of others, of acting when others are off balance, fuels many of the skip-the-line techniques described in this book. James Vince says, "You just started doing stand-up comedy when? 2 years ago? People have been doing it for years and years and aren't getting the spots you are getting. You have to just take your time. There's an order to this. First you do the open mics, then you do the check spot, then maybe you can be the MC. Then you go from 5 minutes to 10 minutes. You start doing other clubs. You have to do some spots on TV. And then you could start closing the show or traveling." He's staring at his drink. We're in a comedy club uptown. Photos of Jim Gaffigan, Tiffany Haddish, Dave Chappelle, all sorts of comedians surround us. Vince drives a Con Edison truck during the day and fixes underground electric lines. He's 2 years from retirement. He's been doing stand-up comedy for 20 years. He's very funny. He's a big guy. I think he's half Hispanic, half African-American. I can't even tell. He's half something and half another thing. He wears rings on each finger and a big fur coat. He has this one joke that I love. He sits on the stool on stage, and he relaxes and leans back, and he's just having a conversation with the audience. He says to the audience, "I've been stabbed twice. I told this girl I was dating about my stab wounds. She says, 'Oh, I like that. You sound dangerous.' I said to her, 'I don't think you understand what stab wounds are. It's the guy that did the stabbing who's dangerous.' People always laugh. I laugh." When you've been doing it a few years, Vince tells me, you learn to be in the pocket where you got the laugh, and you now can take it wherever you want. You can control the stage. But you have to wait your turn, man. You're just a baby at this. You can't jump ahead. It will happen. John, the manager that night, calls out to me, James, you're up. And now I'm all nervous. I've just been told I can't skip the line, and I'm about to do 45 minutes in front of 150 people, and it's my first time doing stand-up for that long. Vince has been doing it for 20 years. But after what he had just said to me, I've totally lost confidence. Maybe he's right, but it's too late to be scared.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.